Hello, I will speak about the place of the small languages in on Wikimedia projects. Small languages or native language or local language. I don't know what is the best word to explain, but I want to share with you some facts and some challenge that we have in the Wikimedia France chapter since we work with overseas territories and West and Central Africa for some projects. Please apologize for my very bad English and accent in English. So to explain why we work about languages, I just want to explain the story of our project. In fact, we start last year when the General Department of French Language and Languages of France, a section of the Ministry of Culture in France, asked us to produce a report about French language on Wikimedia projects. We didn't understand why they asked us about that, but we did the report and sent to the Ministry of Culture without any contacts with them. And after a few weeks, maybe 1 month, they give us a response and said to us that they include the report in the annual report about French language sent to all the French parliament and government. Each year in France, the French Ministry of Culture make a report about the state of French in the country. After that, we meet the digital manager of the department and this team because they want to discuss with us about the role of Wikipedia and Wiktionary, especially Wiktionary, for languages on internet, because they think that it's very important to have a big visibility on the internet. And in our report, we show that French language have a very good place on Wikimedia projects related to the real place of French language in the world. So we were invited to participate in a very big conference about multilingualism in French Guiana. You know where is the French Guiana in South Africa? And we were two Wikimedians going to Guiana just to explain what is Wikipedia, what is the Wiktionary, what is the importance of Wikimedia projects in internet, and encourage and train people to contribute and learn and understand the Wikimedia project in French and in their native language. We did a second report about languages of overseas territories on Wikimedia project, and it's not very good. We have only two languages of overseas territories on Wikimedia project, and maybe 10 or 15 in regional language in France. I put a map of the different languages in France. We have more than 70 languages spoken in France. On another side, we start some projects related to Africa and to give access to Wikipedia offline in West and Central Africa, where a lot of people speak French. The project called Afripedia, maybe you read a blog on the blog post on the blog of the foundation last week. And this project gives us a lot of contacts with people who speak their native language and French. And French is always the language used in university, administration, press, etc. And they use their language at home and with their friends and family. At the same time, we study the state of African content, overseas content in the French Wikipedia, and we see that it's not very present, and we don't have a good state of content in this subject. For example, some cities in Africa with those maybe 200,000 of inhabitants don't have article in French Wikipedia, and for French cities we have some articles about village with 70 people. We know that 70% of the contributors on the French Wikipedia are from France, but mainland France, and more than 90% are from Europe and Canada, Quebec. But we don't have a lot of contributors from Africa and overseas territories. So it's very, for us, it's not a, a good thing. So we decide to help to create content about the these cultural areas and these languages on French Wikipedia. We decide to promote Wikipedia in French and promote Wikipedia in the French territories, so promote in the local language. And we want to give our strength to help Francophonie, so the group of Francophone countries, with a special focus on multilingualism, not just in French, but in all the languages spoken in these countries. So when we start this project, we see a lot of challenge. The first is geography. Because the French chapter is most active in mainland France, and I put a map about the overseas territories of France, and you see that we have a very, very large area, and the overseas are frequently very, very far, so it's not very easy to for us to go to New Caledonia or in other highland in Pacific just to do a workshop for a new Wikipedian. And as I said before, the main part of the contributors are from Europe and a few people from other other area. But we note that Tunisian Wikipedians are very active since a few months, and maybe it is a future chapter or future very active community, so it's very good. The second challenge is language. Because native languages are often oral language, they are not written, like a lot of Amerindian language or Kanak in New Caledonia language, they are not never written. And some of them were written in the 70s or 80s centuries, but now it is contested by folks that don't like this kind of written. And some of them have several type of writing. For example, in Mayotte Island, near Madagascar, the language, Shimaware, is written in Arabic and Latin writing. So it's very difficult to, for example, to create a Wikipedia because we have two kind of written. So, and what can we do with some language spoken by a very, very small community? For example, in New Caledonia, you have a kind of Kanak language spoken by less than 400 people. What can we do for this language, never written and spoken by a very small community? Can we start a Wikipedia? Can we start a Wiktionary? We don't know if it is a good idea. I put a map about the languages in Central and West Africa. You can see that we have a lot of different language, and some of them are not written. The another challenge is for technology. In a lot of this area, we have a very bad quality to access to internet. In Africa, for example, access to internet is very expensive, and a lot of people doesn't have access at home to internet. So they cannot just walk from a page to another page to another page on Wikipedia like we do at home and just learn some content. They must go to an internet cafe and pay for each minute, each hour on internet. So it's not a very good situation to to read and to write on Wikipedia. And it is not only in Africa, but in some places in France too. If you are going in the Amazonian forest in French Guiana, you don't have access to internet. In some highlands in Pacific, we cannot have a very good access to internet. Another challenge is a mental break. So when I discuss with a lot of people especially in overseas territories, they said to me that their language are used for private and traditional conversation, but never for scientific or for science, for abstract facts. They use their language only at home and with friends. And they have not the vocabulary to write some encyclopedic articles in their language. And they say that they must release something in their mind to write encyclopedic articles. It's not easy for them. They just write in French. And often they need to find some new words to describe the facts and or insert French words in their language, and it's not very easy. And in some tribal folks, especially in New Caledonia and in Amazonian area, the language is the property of the folks. You cannot give your language to other people who are not from the same folks as you. So it's very difficult to put content in their language on the internet because this is a property of the folks. So it's not very easy to do something. But we start some projects I just explained some of them. The first project we do is to collaborate with an institution dedicated to promote the language. In France, we have the General Department for French Language and Languages of France, and we work with them to help people who want to contribute on Wikipedia, to release some content on Wikimedia Commons, for example. We help them to contribute. And we start projects with the university department in the International Organization of Francophonie, because they have a lot of contacts of experience, they know the right people, and they know the people in all the countries. And they can give us their help to have content with free license or to project content. For example, after the conference in French Guiana, we have some audio files about very small languages of Pacific area. And for a lot of them, this is the only way to hear this kind of language. The languages are not written, and you don't have any content in this language on the internet. The second kind of project we do is to give a better access to Wikipedia. The Afripedia project with West and Central Africa is a project to give offline access to Wikipedia with frequent updates of the content. And we do that especially with the universities of West Africa. And in the same time, we organize some workshops to train new contributors and help them to start their contribution on Wikipedia. And we see a very, very big need to training, to have some help to contribute. And we want to give help and to follow the project during a long time, not just for one workshop or one day or one conference. Not just giving the basis of the contribution on project, but conduct the projects for over time with a very a very good collaboration between the people and Wikipedians. This photography is an example. We were last week in Canada for a big conference about French language, and a lot of people in our stand were from Africa, and they spent a long time with us to learn to contribute and to have the good basis to contribute to Wikipedia. And third project is to help to create new Wikimedia projects, especially new Wiktionaries, because we think that Wiktionary is a very, very good project to promote a language and to help to fix the language when it is not very present on internet. And we want to have a better use of the Wikimedia incubator, because we have a lot of Wikimedia projects in the incubator, and they never grow. And sometimes we try to get back some old projects. For example, in French Guiana, I spoke with an Indian guy from Saramaka folks, and he started to write an encyclopedia in the end of 20th century, and he said to me that it is possible to get back the content to make a basis for a new Wiktionary or a new Wikipedia in Saramaka language, and maybe we can try to get back some content. And we can do some educational projects. We try to propose to write and translate some articles at the same time in French and in the native language, because French Wikipedia is very, very big, and it has a very good visibility. And if we have the content in French with an interwiki to the native language, we think it's very good to promote the native language. So we try to do some educational projects like this. I just give you some links if you want to read other things about this subject. The first link is on the Wikimedia France website. You just find études et rapports. It's a link, and you see the report about French language and the overseas language. And the second is for the Afripedia project in French on our website, and in English and French on the Wikimedia Foundation blog. So I just want to discuss with you if you have some questions or other point of view about the question of small language, if you think we are in the right way or in a bad way, and just ask me.
Whatever. I'm from Wikimedia Chile, and we have been working for a year trying to create a project, a Wikipedia edition in Mapudungun language, which is the language of the Mapuche people, the main indigenous group in Chile. It's around 500,000 speakers in Chile, and also in Argentina. And we've been working a lot with the we've been trying to talk with the communities, and it's really interesting to see that most of the challenges you talk for the communities in African languages or in the Pacific or the Caribbean are exactly the same that we are dealing in South America. One of the most important things, in my opinion, is trying to be as close as possible with the communities. I think, after all, someday they will be in charge of the projects, and we need to help them the most as best as we can, but they should be in charge of the communities, of the project. The main problem with all these indigenous languages is that there are no internet communities in that language. Because for us in Spanish or French or most of the other European languages or Occidental or Western communities, you have group of people talking in internet in their language. And that's why, that was how every Wikipedia project started. They said, okay, we need a Wikipedia, perfect. But now there are no Mapudungun people in internet speaking Mapudungun. If you look in the internet, there are no community or forum or etc. So you need to create first a community. And that's one of the main challenges we have, I think, is that the incubator is not a place to create a community. It's really hard to work there because I don't know if you have tried to edit on the incubator. Because you have to put the code for the project, code for the language. So every time you need to create an article, you start with, in the case of Mapudungun, with the brackets, wvp/arn/ the name of the article, and all the stuff for people who is new to internet. So I think one of the, if you want to improve the accessibility of people of these communities, we need to change the incubator. Yes, I think it's that's one of the main things that we as Wikimedia movement, part of the Wikimedia movement, we need to do. They are going to create the articles about the things that they really care. In the case of the Mapudungun people, most of them speak Spanish. So if they need to talk to see the population of Berlin, they will ask the Spanish Wikipedia. But if they want to talk to read about the Giyatun, which is a traditional ceremony for them, they will look for an Mapudungun Wikipedia, and we need to let them write the articles. But we need to create the space for how the community to grow, and incubator is not the place.
Yes, last week I met some people from Maghreb, Algeria, Morocco, Tunisia, and a lot of them speak Berber, Hamazic language. 45 million people spoke this language, and we have only 34 articles on the incubator. It's a very big problem. And we tried to write incubator, and it was impossible for a new contributor to write something in incubator.
One who has been working Wikipedia for 8 years, I don't want to imagine how it's difficult for them.
Maybe another question?
Two questions. So about, question one is, for communities that, especially communities that don't have a long online tradition, is creating a Wikipedia in their language a good idea for a first step? Or should we be talking more about, has anyone tried, or have you tried, talking about wiki books, or about some of the other projects, or Wiktionary.
Wiktionary, that's why I mentioned
like Wiktionary. Actually offline things, like here is the school textbook about science or whatever for children in that language, if they don't have textbooks already. And secondly, so first it's about different, not Wikipedia projects. And secondly, if you have multiple small languages in your jurisdiction, so all the languages you said in France or in Australia, there are dozens of Aboriginal languages. How do you prioritize which one to go for? Is there a politically correct way to choose? Do you wait for them to come to you? As a chapter, how do you decide on priorities?
When I discuss with people in Guyana, they want to be on internet. They want to promote their language on internet, and they understand that the Wikimedia projects are a very, very good way to fix and promote and sustain a language. So they come to us to ask us how can we create our Wikipedia and the thing. African people I met last week, for example, have the same thing. They want to have their Wikipedia. They want to have their a place on internet to share their culture, their language, etc. But I agree with you. I don't think create a Wikipedia is a first thing to do. Maybe Wiktionary or Wikisource. We think about Wikisource. It's a good way, but if people want to write some articles for in Wikipedia, we cannot say no, you must not. But we decide to sustain some educational projects to help to create content offline and after that to put on the internet. Maybe the last question, you are two people, but the woman said 1 minute.
I think I'm loud enough. The reason why one could possibly think of Wikipedia to start is that Wikipedia is a trade name. If you go to Southern Africa, where I'm from, and you tell them about Wiki News, they will recognize the Wiki, but not the news, and they will or even Wiktionary.
Yes.
So I think there's a good point to say we could possibly start with Wikipedia. At least in Sub-Saharan Africa, they know what it is. They actually, the ones who have internet access, particularly the young population in resource centers or at schools, normally not at home. They know what Wikipedia is and they use it every day.
Yeah.
They're just not, not well enough educated in English. In our case now, we are Anglophone area, to really contribute on their own. But I think an important point was raised with the incubator, because it's really, I would consider myself conversant with Wikipedia, with the English Wikipedia. And I just before that session, some nice chap showed me a few new tricks how I could actually work on the incubator. And it's even like that. We ran a translation session for Oshi Ndonga and Oshi Herero. And after a month or so, I say, where are our articles? Where are they? I know they have been created. I stood behind the people writing them.
Yes.
And then I realized, yeah, they didn't get that URL right. And did of course not know what a category is. So this page was dumped somewhere on the incubator and it wasn't even categorized which language it is. And that's of course something that also a local administrator can't do because they don't know what language it is either. So I found a few of them, but I'm pretty sure there are a number of articles in Oshi Ndonga and Oshi Herero that are flying around somewhere on the incubator, which I just haven't found yet.
Yes.
So something at least for the people to say automatically say I will write in this language and then to channel the rest through to say this cannot go somewhere else, that would be helpful.
Maybe you can the last.
So I'm also from the Southern Africa.
Yes.
South Africa, not just the South. I've got two questions for you, and it's just a pity I had something else I needed to complete, so I am late for your session. But I attended the Wiki Africa presentation yesterday,
mm-hmm.
and I'm seeing some parallels with this project. Are you guys in communication with?
Yes, we are. But Wiki Africa is like a GLAM project, and we have Afripedia is a offline project. So we are in contact, but our project is to build some intranet access in universities to share Wikipedia or Wiktionary content. It's different than Wiki Africa, but we are in contact. Yes.
A good project. The second one is there's a lot of oral knowledge in African countries, in African languages, and there's a big problem of
yes.
reference, which is the Wikipedia's trademark. Every article has to have a reference. I work on the Xitsonga Wikipedia, and I can tell you right now, I've struggled to find reference down to a single book that was written in the 1895 by a Swiss missionary and has only got into a public domain now. That's the only reason I was able to find it. So Wikipedia might have to change the way they think around small languages, especially in Africa, where oral history and oral knowledge is not referenced or referenced.
Yes, and we don't have solution now, but last week a Cameroon guy tried to write an article about a legend in Cameroon on French Wikipedia, and I say to him, oh, we must find a reference for this article. And we start to speak about this problem of oral reference. And he said to me, it's your problem. My reference is tradition, and it's your problem. So I think we must be think different. And in the beginning of Wikipedia, in 7 years ago, on French Wikipedia, I start to contribute without reference. I just put my content, and if somebody was not don't agree with me, I put a reference. So I think we must be very open about that, and maybe have a video reference or audio files. I don't know, but I think we must find a solution to accept article with oral reference. Yes, I think. And I think that the communities in French Wikipedia, for English I don't know, but I think they are in the good way to change their mind about reference, I think. So we must stop. Thank you.
I'm Richard Jensen, and I'm talking on the battles of the War of 1812. Not the battles 200 years ago, but the battles in the last 24 months on the War of 1812. So let's see if we can get the access here. It's a great statue in downtown Toronto that I will talk about a little later. Well, what does Wikipedia cover? Wikipedia covers a lot of things, and I'm only interested in the historical topics, and to a certain extent the military history topics, which get included in this rather wide variety. Talking here about English Wikipedia with over 3 million articles. Hard to believe there could be 3 million articles.
4 million.
God, have we reached 4 million?
Today.
Good morning here, all right. What do students actually look for? Most of the research on Wikipedia is by the editors, by the authors. And this is very unusual. In the scholarly literature on studies of the impact of reference books is about the readers. But in the Wikipedia world, it's about the authors. So I'll talk a little bit about the readers. We do have a study on students at the elementary and high school level. And what are their searches? These are not Wikipedia, these are Google searches. The kids want to know about games, dogs, animals. Ah, but they have history classes that they have to take. And so the number 4, the number 5, the number 6, the number 7 searches by these elementary and secondary students in the United States are history. Then we have multiplication and math, and then finally we're down to frogs and fractions and planets, and what they really want to know about are snakes. So, sharks and frogs. So, who uses it? Well, everybody uses it, and the usage pattern is a Monday to Friday pattern, which strongly suggests that it's either used by people at work who should be doing their business, or it's used by students. The average time on Wikipedia for all articles is only 4.5 minutes. People, the great majority of people, are browsing for specific information rather than reading in depth. They want summaries. They're probably just, if you're only spending 4 to 5 minutes on it, you're going to be only reading the opening lead paragraph. But they're advanced users too. And the advanced users are much more interested in content and not only the main text, they're interested in the graphics. Some of them, I hope, as a professional historian myself, some of them, I hope, are interested in the footnotes and the bibliographies. And they're interested in things like the maps and the links to other articles. Well, we have history of the War of 1812 is a balance between viewpoints from Canada, the United States, and Great Britain. And I want to compare it briefly to the usage of some other articles. Here's History of Canada, which is getting 30-some thousand hits a month. And Canada is 1/10 the size of the United States. Here's the American Revolution, getting 140,000 article hits every month, and it's with spikes from time to time, like a spike on the 4th of July. And then the American Civil War is one of the heavy-duty articles, 330,000, about 10,000 or so a day. And so we're putting the War of 1812 in a context of 300,000 hits in the last 30 days. World War II has almost 700,000 hits. And of course, it's a worldwide phenomenon. The War of 1812 is has more hits than the American Civil War, 390,000 in the last 30 days, and it's a high-ranking sort of article. So there's a remarkable level of interest compared to other wars. It's not a forgotten war. It's a, I won't call it well-studied, but well-hit war in terms of usage on Wikipedia. If we compare it to the other military history articles, it ranks number 59. Military history is a very popular field in Wikipedia. Number 57 is Mussolini, 58 is Joan of Arc, 59 is War of 1812, followed by Battleship, Harry Truman, Spartacus, and the AK-47, which I think in this little snippet gives a good idea of what the people in military history are really interested in. Here's the edit history for the World War II. And it's kind of interesting. Wikipedia, you'll notice the upsurge in 2006, especially. Most articles, most of the major articles, the important articles in Wikipedia, were written in 2006. Wikipedia, in terms of the important main articles, like World War II, is a six-year-old reference work. We want to think of it that way, with revisions ever since, although you'll notice in World War II that the revision history in recent years has dribbled off. We're long in tooth. Wikipedia is long in tooth. And this is, as I say, World War II and one of the most important of all the military history articles in Wikipedia. The War of 1812 is rather similar, except it was mostly written in 2006, but it had a burst of energy. I would have thought in 2012, but oh no, no. The burst of energy comes in a couple years earlier as people are preparing for the anniversary of the War of 1812 and they're starting to get interested in it, I suspect is what happened. Here it is 2012 and you can see the attention, these are edits. These are the edits, the attention of editors has dribbled off. Instead of 9,000 a month, we're down to a few hundred a month. Well, let's look at the 1812 article, the War of 1812. It runs 14,000 words in the main text, and there's a lot of other stuff in it. Footnotes, for example, an info page and links to this and that. But the main text is quite reasonably length at 14,000 words. There are only four maps. There are 16 illustrations, of which five are given here. There are 169 footnotes. That's a lot. And there's a short bibliography, but there's also a very long bibliography of a separate article that is spun off on it. There are over 600 links to other Wikipedia articles. Every battle, every general, every colonel, I think every captain and major now is getting his own article. And one woman gets an article, two women get an article on that. Laura Secord is the Canadian heroine on it. And Mrs. James Madison gets attention as well. There are 7,000 different articles in Wikipedia out of the 4 million that are linked to it. That drops the percentage a little bit, so my 3 million to 4 million as a base. But 7,000 articles make a reference to the War of 1812. That's a lot of references. A person could spend a good chunk of their high school career reading all the things about the War of 1812. In terms of maps, there are only four maps. This is a serious weakness of Wikipedia military history in general, and this article in particular. There are no battle maps. One is on the bottom right is an old historic map that is very hard to read. There's the most useful map probably is that center bottom on where some of the naval engagements took place. The one on the left is a very minor aspect of the War of 1812. There's no references to, the war on the, and the map on the upper right looks suspiciously like copied from a textbook. And I won't push the copyright issue too hard on that, but it looks exactly like some of the maps that you will find in undergraduate history textbooks. This is the contents of the article, and it's the emphasis is, you could read the article, so I will explain what I find in it. It started in December 2001. Did I say December 200? It's making it a little older than I would want. It's 2001, sorry about that. With the 2,000 words copied directly from the 1911 edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Many, I would say several thousand history articles are copied originally from the Encyclopedia Britannica of 1911, and in fact still many of them still reflect that. Indeed, many of the biographical articles in Wikipedia are little more, hardly changed from that old Encyclopedia Britannica. Well, that's a way to get started. It is, shall we say, old-fashioned indeed to use that as your main framework. But that was the intellectual theoretical framework for the conceptualization of the article from the beginning. And to a large extent, that organizational conceptualization has little changed. We're still using the conceptualization of 1911, in other words, on what, how to balance the important topics of that article.
How many articles were copied from the Britannica?
The recent revisions of it, as of this week, well, they look like this. You all know about those things, and I won't push that too much. What are Wikipedia authors, Wikipedia editors like? Well, they're students. 40% of them are enrolled in school. And on the bottom, 24% of our editors, this is for all Wikipedia English articles, 24% are under the age of 21. So you've got a, they cut it off at age 40. So the old age category comprises about 30%. And I won't lay a claim to being one of the oldest, if not the oldest. I first taught the War of 1812 in 1966, when it was fresh in people's minds. So here are the people who've written it. 2,400 different editors have had their hand in this. They have made nearly 10,000 edits since 2001. That's a great amount of attention. These are the changes. 24% of those are coded as minor. That's a self-coding thing. 37% of the people were anonymous, and most of them were making only one hit and miss edit. But there are approximately 1,400 editors who made it two or more edits to that article over the last 10 or so years. Turns out I'm the most active one. I got started in it in 2006 with 300 edits, and then there are a bunch of other people. I'm one of the relatively few editors who uses a real name. Although that got challenged in one little edit battle, people decided I couldn't possibly have used a real name, but indeed I did. And some of the other people actually do too. But to find out what the editors are like, I did two things. First of all, I interviewed some of them, and secondly, I checked on to see what other articles they edit. And so let me talk about Dabbler, Tyrone, Narson, and so on. Number two, Dabbler has 10,000 edits. And his interest is clearly the Royal Navy. He's a Brit, has a British emphasis. 236 edits he did to the Isle of Man. Rudyard Kipling, Trampoline. Well, that may tell you more about him than it tells you about trampolines. Oscar Wilde, Battle of Trafalgar. This is a profile of an editor, and it's clearly an English person. We're interpreting this edit history. He's English, and with a strong interest in both trampolines and the Napoleonic Wars. This is called original research of the sort. I'm not allowed to put on Wikipedia, mind you, but if you don't tell anybody, it's still allowed at the Wikimania conference. Narson's number three. He's recently retired. His number one, he's a military historian, all right, and here are the type of things he does. USS Liberty was an attack on American ship by Israel 20 years ago. East India Company has to do with India. The Falklands War was a British-Argentine war. And so he has a variety of interests. His own background looks strongly American history, U.S. Marine Corps, the Iranian seizure of Royal Navy personnel indicates he has a broader interest in the Navy and so on. But then I asked him, and so I wrote the guy. I retired from Wikipedia due to disenchantment with the dispute resolution process. It was more and more difficult to deal with a growing antipathy to expert contributions, including outright hostility from administrators to cover up their own errors. Well, the historian reading that chalks it up as an encroaching bureaucracy on the academic freedom of the expert editor, is the way I would read that statement that he wrote in a private email to me. Turonin, 4,000 edits, he's now retired, and his most active was Battle of Borodino, that's Napoleon in Russia, Battle of Waterloo, War of 1812, French invasion of Russia. This is pretty straightforward, except the Zumwalt class destroyer is an American warship, and that gives a clue that of some of the taste of he has an interest in naval topics, interest in the War of 1812, and Christianity and violence comes in as a subject that he's edited also. So you can get a profile. We don't know the person's name, maybe, but in fact, what his editing interests are clues to what his writing interests are, his reading interests, and indeed even his personality, or in the case of the trampoline, the guy's, one suspects the guy was actually using that trampoline. I have to add a personal note. My daughter got a in college, she was at a school that required phys ed courses, and she took tennis. And I wanted to congratulate her. Joe, I says, you got an A minus in tennis, and I'm very proud of you. And I've seen you out playing tennis, and you can't hit the ball. Well, no, Daddy, but the teacher really liked my essays that I wrote on tennis. So maybe this guy just writes essays on trampolines, but I think we are deducing that actually he jumps up and down on them a lot. Driftwood Zebulin, you can make a good case for using real names, I think. 2,400 edits, superpower, space exploration, War of 1812, timeline of space exploration. So he's primarily a recent military historian with a strong space interest. North American Free Trade Agreement indicates a strong interest in, that's an American-Canadian topic. So you could explore that a little more on his what attention span it is. So even more interesting, perhaps, is the talk page. The talk page, people let their hair hang out. There are 3,363 comments on the talk page over the years made by 627 different people. And I counted every one of them. And 15 of those people made half the comments. So we have a core group of 15 people who are, they turn out to be pretty much the same as the authors. But whereas the authors, the editors have on the main article have made a total of 14,000 words, the commentary is running over 200,000 words. It's a full-length book of commentary in which this is adding all those talk pages together. And in fact, the most active users is Death Librarian, comes in first at 347. And these other people are commenting on it. Well, let's turn to the real world for a minute. Canadians think a great deal about the War of 1812. The British totally ignore it. They've got Napoleon. They got a much more interesting war. And there's very little interest, either public or scholarly, in the War of 1812 in England. But in Canada, it's a central part of the Canadian identity, especially in Ontario. And so Maclean's is the leading Canadian news magazine, and it was the victory that made us a nation. Now the Americans are rewriting history by claiming they won, which indeed they do claim. Desmond Morton, a leading Canadian scholar, who won and who lost are vague questions. Both sides tell their kiddies that they won it. Both sides are probably telling some of the truth, which is unusual when you have official history. Well, some of the truth. The one American who taught in Canada for a year discovered that what the Canadian kids, and this is Alberta, what the Canadian kids want to talk about is how we burned down the White House. There's a strong anti-Canadian, anti-American theme in Canadian high schools and Canadian colleges. And so the War of 1812 was when the Canadians, burnt down the American White House. It was the British who did it. There's some question, were there any Canadians on the expedition that burned down the White House? And that leads to a debate that there may actually have been a few Canadians in the particular army that did the burning. Canadians do polls. And polling of all Canadians, 37% said it was a Canadian victory, 9% said it the Americans won, and 15% call it draw. But 39% of Canadians know too little to comment. These are the kids in school, and they're not taught it anymore. War of 1812 seems to be dropping out of the Canadian curriculum. It was a powerful effect in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s, but these under generation, I mean, the millennial generation has... In Ontario, the area where most of the Canadian part of the war was fought, half of the Ontarios think Canadians won. But in Quebec, which was part of the war itself, but it's French Quebec that has a strong distaste for English Canada, only 8% of the people in Quebec say the Canadians won. So in Canada, the neighboring provinces, 50% in Ontario and 8% in Quebec, are identifying their country as the winner. The problem is Ontario, the people in Quebec don't quite identify with Canada, and the people in Ontario identify with all of Canada. They are Canada. And so this leads to the monument in Toronto, which is 2008. Fascinating monument. It's these are twice life size. The opening photo showed a woman passing it by. She's much smaller than these. These are toy soldiers. And the victorious Canadian soldier, well, turns out they put him in a Newfoundland uniform. I think the artist didn't realize that Newfoundland was not really part of Canada at the time, but leaving aside that, and the American uniform on the downed soldier. Well, these, of course, are very accurate uniforms. And the tourists and the local residents in Toronto, this is their view of the war. This is us Canadians beating, defeating, destroying those Americans. But look at it a little more closely. What's on their feet? Those are toy soldiers. And the artist is ridiculing war. It's a game that children play with toy soldiers, and you knock one of them over. And that's a stupid child's game. This is not an image of heroic victory. This is a postmodern image of both sides are stupid children playing childish games. And that's the main monument in Canada today, which, as I say, a viewpoint for tourists or passersby, and a closer up look by that I just gave you. Well, who won the war? That was a case for mediation on Wikipedia that went on for 2 months. And there were 13 drafts of a compromise, and finally there was unanimous agreement on number 13. I think we had to expel somebody to get that unanimity, but basically with very active participation by a bunch of people. Well, who won? Everybody claimed victory. The Canadians, the Americans, and the British. The British didn't pay much attention. And by the 21st century, by today, it's a forgotten war, mostly forgotten in the United States. I was just chatting with someone who says that the New Yorkers don't seem to be paying much attention. They had important battles, but they don't build monuments, don't pay much attention to them anymore. It's forgotten in Britain, and it's forgotten in Quebec, who isn't sure who won that war in the first place. But it is not forgotten in Ontario. The big losers of the war, historians are unanimous on this, are the Indians. The Indians played a major role in causing the war, and they were decisively defeated both in Canada at one battle in 1813 and in the southern part of the United States when Andrew Jackson massacred the Creek Indians in the south. Now, the Canadians never mention the Indians. The Canadian authors have not been talking about the Indians because the Indians lost, and that can't be part of their history. Now, the official historiography of Canada, the official national ideology is multiculturalism, and in which the Indians, the First Nations they call them, are an integral and decisive part of the of Canadian nation today and Canadian history. Except the Canadian authors, in fact, almost all the authors, have erased out the Indians. They lost, and therefore they're not real Canadians. The real Canadians are the winners. So the Canadians have been erasing their own history and going against their own current national ideology to do it. Well, the majority of historians come up in the Wikipedia consensus with a stalemate interpretation. But there's a minority view of a British victory. And there's a new British book actually on this the last couple of months. The British achieved their objectives by stopping the American invasion of Canada, and Canada retained its independence from the United States. So we put that in as minority viewpoint number one. Majority viewpoint being stalemate. Minority viewpoint number two, the US won by upholding its honor, by standing up to the most powerful nation in the world, by destroying the Indian threat, and by stopping the impressment and hostile procedures of the British Royal Navy. So that's minority viewpoint number two we put in the consensus. Well, backing away a little bit and looking at more military history generally in Wikipedia. The strengths of the article are in green and the weaknesses are in red. The technical military work is excellent, in my opinion. And the battle coverage is superb. And we've been putting in more on historiography and memory now. That's what a professional sign of professional historians is, to look for a section called historiography and memory. So what historians today talk about is memory. Not what happened in 1813, but what happens today to remember that war, like this talk. This talk is a professional historical talk. It's not about the Battle of 1812. It's about our memory of the battle and the war of 1812. There's very little new, very little social, economic, or cultural history. It jumps around a little bit. Well, that's a common Wikipedia problem of jumping around. But the absence of social, economic, and cultural history, this is the War of 1812 as seen from Barnes & Noble bookstore, which is loaded with studies of the military history of that war and other, many other wars, and is very weak on historiography and journal articles. There are very few journal articles that are referenced by most of the historians, most of the editors, because they haven't read the journals. They are unfamiliar with the scholarly literature. They're familiar with the advanced popular military literature. There are also copyright issues, and this this ruins the maps. Military history needs maps, and it needs your good maps, not the old historic maps, but modern maps. And Wikipedians, very few of them can or do draw them, a few do. And Wikipedia does not allow, even under its fair use rules, significant usage of images. And Wikipedia will not fund it either. This is something the Wikipedia Foundation should be using its money for, original necessary artwork, in my opinion, that is not available from either the volunteers or from, you need money. You need money to do it right. And the money is not being spent on artwork that would be used by Wikipedia. Well, they're weak on morale, desertion, medical care. They want victories. People who write military history are interested in the bayonet charge rather than the hospital care given to the wounded soldiers afterwards. So there's much more bayonet work and much less scalpel work in Wikipedia. They're very good on many other linkages. They're very weak on the scholarship. There are 1,400 articles on the War of 1812 in the scholarly literature, and only a handful are cited. The home front's ignored. The military historians could care less about the financing of the war, but it's just not there. Anyone could edit. That's not really a problem. There's 600 different people who are watching that article every day. And vandalism doesn't last very long. Currently, in the Military History Project, there's 700 editors who are part of the Military History Project itself, and they have 50-some thousand articles. Boy, if you want military history, Wikipedia English has 50-some thousand of them right now. And so in summary, we've got a lot of 13,000 people looking at the war, that article, and over 2,000 people have edited it. And it's old-fashioned, it's amateur, it's military. And I think the disputes are handled well, but I did quote one of the contributors who resigned and quit because he was disgusted with the Wikipedia's military resolution techniques. Thank you.
About 15 minutes.
It's not just a question, actually. It's a request for having a copy of the presentation because I liked it very much. And since we have some problems, let's say, with the local wiki military history project on the Italian Wikipedia, I really, really would like them to read your presentation in order to be, you know.
Thank you. It's online.
Thanks a lot.
I'm happy to say it's online. If you can read it there, it's www.americanhistoryprojects.com/1812b-wkppt.
He'll leave that up there for a minute.
I'll leave that.
Yeah, all the presentations are going to be up on the
YouTube. All the lecture will be in YouTube.
And I've got a computer. I'll give you a flash drive version of it right now.
Right. They also have, you can always do the email to rjensen@uic.edu, and he can send it to you if you make a mistake on the URL.
So, quick question. Talked a lot about bias, and like when you have this open encyclopedia with a lot of people editing it with different viewpoints, facts are, I mean, there's really no way to get like truly neutral facts. Is there some way to automate like a bias detection system? Like, is there a bot made to find bias?
Bias. All the facts I think in the article are correct. I find no factual errors. The question is who won and who lost the war. Yeah, the question is actually the memory of the war is much more important than any of the details. There's almost no conflict on exactly what happened at 9 a.m. at the Battle of XYZ. There's almost no conflict. There's a little bit of uncertainty of what happened at 10 o'clock, but you know they cover that very, very well. No, it's the memory of the war where the fighting takes place. Who won, who lost, what it means to us. What it means to Ontario today is entirely different than what it means to the Indians today, and entirely different from what it means to Quebec today. And that's just in Canada, inside Canada. As I say, the Americans pay much less attention to the war, mostly because they're interested in the winners of the war are the great generals who become president. Andrew Jackson, the most important, William Henry Harrison, is an important general. He becomes president, and there are a couple others who run for president but don't quite make it, like General Winfield Scott. So the Americans are interested in the political long-term reverberations, which is not too controversial. All historians agree that the war makes Jackson president of the United States. That it's not a debated issue. So there is no factual debate over facts. There's a debate over the meaning of the memory of the war, which makes it a little more interesting.
So do you think the criticism section is the best place to get, because I'd love to read all different types of viewpoints from different people. Is the criticism section the best place to do that?
Much more on the talk page. The talk page is where the real action takes place. If you can wade through 200,000 words of talk page, 200,000, that's 20 times longer than the article. 15 times longer than the article. And heated.
Anyway, I was happy to see that in the list of the earliest edits, I showed up there with a minor edit to correct the name of an admiral.
All right.
But that was in 2002. But yeah, the other thing that I noted was that quotation and the toy soldiers is that Paul Copeland is a British Columbia writer, a bit of a quirky writer, and would recommend some of his stories to anybody. But
the fellow who does the artwork.
I don't know if he did the artwork, but he is a writer, and sometimes dealing with novels that are based on the way people behave on, in and around the internet. I think there was recently something on TV about the war. I believe it was primarily a Canadian production, but it also showed up on PBS. It had, you know, it seemed to have done a fair representation of that. But with the Indians, the way that they were viewed in that program and in a lot of the other ways is, the Indians were quite upset with the British by the end of the war, even though they sided with the British at the beginning. And there is there's ongoing repercussion over the Haldimand Tract, which was a large area of land that was promised to the Indians by the British for their help in the war. And it was a basis for some sit-ins a couple of years ago.
Thank you.
I don't think that it's really an issue of memory. I think it's more about the interpretation of the results. And if you look at the Vietnam War, there may be some issues of memory there, and we debate over that even still today. Some say we lost the war in Vietnam, obviously on sort of a technical reason, but it has a lot of merit for other arguments that we may make. So I think the point being that it's just a matter of an interpretation rather than memory so much. But the other thing that I think we also have to keep in mind is context. When I read about the American Civil War, I found out that Canada was actually a factor in the Civil War. That took me by surprise. I didn't realize that. And I learned that at that time, Canada didn't trust us. There was some opposition there. And it wasn't until, I believe, World War I that Canada changed their view upon Americans and we became more friendly. So again, I just think it's an issue of context, especially when we're thinking of something that happened so many years ago.
Yes, I quite agree. It's a matter of context and interpretation. But as I say, there's almost no debate on the factual history of the war. On any one battle, on any one episode, there's almost no debate to speak of. The debate is over what it means. You know, and it phrased most succinctly in who won or who lost. Or is this statute, both sides are playing stupid children's games. At least that's the way I read the statute. That's an interpretation of the war. An interpretation which no editor holds, to my knowledge. People who think the war is really stupid, I have not been editing actively. Yeah.
So, this was alluded to, that the article is very long. I just looked at it, it's about 140 bytes, which is, and I think the normal kind of guideline for maximum article size is about half that, so it's very, very long. So, I have two questions. One is, why do you think it has not been split into smaller articles? Is that just a matter of nobody has taken it on, or is it kind of a cultural thing within military history that they, you know, don't really do that? And the second question is, do you think that its length has discouraged people from expanding it further with these, you know, like social and economic kind of history and other things? Whereas if there was a separate, you know, social history of the War of 1812, it would be more likely to have these kinds of...
Well, those are very good questions. It is a maximum size. I mean, there's size is an issue. It has not stopped the readers. They're clicking like crazy on it, and I suspect that most of them are just reading that introductory lead. The reason there is, and there are hundreds of spin-off articles. The bibliography was getting long and long, and it was spun off, and now there's just a very short bibliography and with a link, see the full length. Every single battle has a full-length article, or several. a major battle like New Orleans will have 10 and 15 and 20 articles devoted to it. So, but yes, there is a strong commitment in the military history world to that wars are units in themselves and have to be covered as units. And even an extremely long and expensive and difficult World War II has to be covered in one article. There's a strong sense of that. And that's why it cannot be based into six subunits. It's like governmental administrations. The reign of Louis XIV, even though it's long, has to be covered in one article. Or the presidency of William Henry Harrison, which was 30 days, it gets an article too. But there's they're natural units in history. And wars are natural units. And battles are also natural units. So you can't break up a battle. Battle part one, battle part two, battle part three. And that's not done. So that's my interpretation of it. But yes, it's much too long. And B, it's much too weak on the politics, the diplomacy, the economics, the social are all missing, or mostly missing.
So I'm actually looking at the prose size of the article. The wiki text is 140 kilobytes. The prose size actually is reported as being a quote-unquote readable prose size of 81 kilobytes.
Yeah, I was counting about 14,000 words, I think, last time I looked at it.
That's roughly what this
about 14,000. I took the main text and put it in Word and used their counter to, you know, and got that approximate number. And I think that's on the high side. If you're a high school student, that's a very long article to read. Well, it's just very long. The kids don't read 14,000 word articles, I think.
So none of the main contributors were also interested in sharks or frogs?
Trampolines. We got trampolines.
I apologize, I missed the first couple minutes, and you might have addressed this briefly at the beginning, but I wonder about the issue of the gender of the contributors, and I know that's a bigger issue with Wikipedia as a whole. It's obviously an issue in military history within the academy, but I wonder if either you or anyone in the audience has any thoughts about whether there are any gender dynamics that are keeping, for example, the women's historians or historians of minorities, anything like that, from trying to come in and contribute this. They're probably busy writing different stuff somewhere else.
Well, women's history overlaps with military history, especially in World War II and recently. The women's historians, until the last 10 years, have largely avoided military history before 1914 or 1945. Women's historians are not interested in the War of 1812. And that I did look at people who write about Dolly Madison, for example, and they're mostly women, and they skirt over the War of 1812 issues. That's not the Dolly Madison they're mostly interested in, the one who rescued pictures in the White House, from the burning by the British. In terms of minorities, the minority we're talking about are Indians, and Indian history is to a large extent military history. So every person who writes on military history does indeed deal with military. Practically everyone, you know, doesn't deal heavily. And so one of the leading Indians of the era was Tecumseh, who was probably the single most important North American Indian of this era. And he has been numerous biographies, many studies, and all of them pay strong attention to his role in the War of 1812. Minorities are covered, women are not, I think I would put it in a nutshell. Only in recent years have we looked at women in the Civil War, for example, or American Revolution, or there's almost nothing on women in the Napoleonic Wars. There must be, 5,000 books on the Napoleonic Wars? I don't know how many thousand, but, you know, many thousands of books, and if there is any, there must be one in French, but I haven't found it yet on women in the Napoleonic Wars. They're all about Josephine, if you want, the emperors. So women's history is a semi-separate field of history that overlaps very, very weakly with military history in general.
You said that one of the weak points of the article is about the lack of social history and medical equipment and home front and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And one of them is because nobody writes it actually in it, or it's because people try to write and are discouraged because it's not serious, and this is a serious war, we're talking about the serious battles, and we don't write about medical history, which we don't care about. Or is it just because
yes.
nobody writes it at all?
That's right. Now, the financing of the war is a central issue, and they don't write about that either. Professional historians are pretty unanimous that the financing and the politics of the war is really important in the American side, certainly, and to a lesser extent on the British side, and they just don't write about that either.
But why? I was going to ask in a related question. Do you think part of the thing is actually that it's mostly military history buffs doing the work and not as many professional historians and trained historians? Because what you're describing in terms of lack of journal articles, in terms of ignoring a large portion of the historiography that ties into things like social history, cultural history, and how those things tie into diplomatic history and stuff, that all, you know, sounds like very typical things that are directed at history programs from undergraduates who want to study traditional military.
Yes, let me say that I taught undergraduates for 40 years, and by far the biggest numbers were in the military history course. They filled the auditorium. It was a male audience, I might add, that filled that auditorium. That was easy to tell. The author, the gender of the editors is impossible to determine.
I also just wanted to say that I am currently studying for my oral exams, and that I want to thank you and everyone for the participation on that, because that was a great article. I was reading through it as a refresher, because I hadn't looked at the war basically for 12 years. And that was one of the most helpful things I've found on Wikipedia, like studying and trying to remember everything and bring back battles and various causes and stuff. It was really
Yeah, thank you. I hope nobody asks you about the politics of the war on your exam.
I looked up some articles about that. That was actually something I had found too. But yeah, no, it was a really good refresher.
Yeah, let me say, the military history is the strong suit in Wikipedia, at least the stuff I read. I don't read the articles on every game show character, you know, although the type of articles I read are about the honeymooners. I mean, that's to get a little historical perspective on that. But basically, I think military history is definitely one of the long suits in Wikipedia. The people are very committed. They're very serious. They do read the Barnes & Noble. What's on the shelves of Barnes & Noble gets read. But journals, you see, are not on the shelves of Barnes & Noble. JSTOR is the place to find the most articles, and the Wikipedia Foundation has decided not to sponsor JSTOR subscriptions for Wikipedia editors. And so I'm working on a project that actually will get military historians linked up with a major military history library and with JSTOR. And I think that I'm talking to people tomorrow and next week about that, and I hope something will arise. But I really think the military historians are devoted, they're very good, and it would dramatically help them if, A, they got access to JSTOR, and the journal articles is what I mean by JSTOR. And secondly, I think it would be a real nice thing if Wikipedia spent a few hundred thousand dollars on making maps, in my opinion. Because you can't, we just don't have the cartographers in real life to do that kind of, yeah.
Has there ever been any conflict between academic editors versus, you know, people who are, you know, quote-unquote lay people you talk about the difference between, you know, getting the Barnes and Nobles kind of the articles. Is there kind of conflict between two groups of people?
Well, it's not a conflict. It's that they write about different things. The person who uses JSTOR is the person who is interested in how James Madison related to the war hawks in Congress. That's a very decisive question for the academic historian. It's of very little interest to the military historian, who's much more interested in what General Hull did at Detroit. And I mean, they're different worlds, and they're writing about, and the Wikipedia is mostly written not by academics. I'm one of the very few academics who does a lot of Wikipedia writing, but in the history field anyway. And in fact, it gets embarrassing. I get known as the historian who writes on Wikipedia in the history profession. you know, he, uh, he, he, it's been revealed that Jensen writes for Wikipedia. We actually have journal articles that have that in the footnote that warn people against me, warn professional historians against me. Yeah.
Giving people access to JSTOR or encouraging people to go to the primary sources, or at least not to secondary sources. The reason that Wikipedia has this favoring of secondary sources is because as encyclopedia editors, we're not really supposed to be specialists. It's not really our place to do the kind of thoughtful and extensive analysis that goes into forming a scholarly consensus. Wikipedia just reports or summarizes that scholarly consensus. So it was important for you to say and be a little more about that.
Well, yes, I that is the Wikipedia policy. You put it in a nutshell. No original research. You summarize the scholarship. And I support that policy 100%. What I'm saying is that JSTOR is the locus of finding that historical scholarship you ought to be using. It has not only hundreds, or I counted 1,400 articles. It not only has the articles, but it has the book reviews that analyze the strengths and weaknesses of current books. That's what the editors need access to, and they don't have access unless they're a university student or, you know, they're different ways. I might add that JSTOR is very generous. They allow easy sharing of JSTOR articles. They encourage people who have JSTOR subscriptions to share single articles with others. I'm very happy to share any JSTOR article that somebody may have heard about. JSTOR's first page is on Google. You Google an article in JSTOR, you'll get the first page. That's a good clue. And if you want more, email me and I'll send you the whole article.
Okay, it is 4:30, so we probably need people to go. Okay,
thank you.
Any more questions? You're welcome.